So we started with righteousness. It's not a word we use very often in everyday language, but in the Bible it was used, and in the cultures of the Bible it was used regularly. It would really mean good. He lived a good life. A righteous life would be a good life. He's a good guy. That's the best way of kind of understanding that. Righteousness also is something that we do horizontally in this world, but is something that we are because God has credited our account with Jesus' righteousness. So we can live a righteous life because Christ lives in us. The gospel is the good news of this story. We looked at how the good news is a message. It's a manner of in the way we live, once again, and it's a mission. It's a responsibility of ours to take the good news, the story of Christ. Just like righteousness, there's a vertical element of the gospel, that it is a choice. I hear the good news. I hear about Jesus, the life of Jesus. I compare that and the claims that he made with my life, realized I'm separated, and I understand the gospel, but it's also something on a horizontal plane. Most easily illustrated, you know, with missionaries who take the gospel to other cultures. And in our church family right now, that's, you know, that's Nicole Duncan. She's on the other side of the world taking the gospel. That's that horizontal plane. That happened because she had the vertical relationship, the gospel explained to her throughout her life, and now she's living it. It's built on our reconciliation with God, that we are forgiven in Christ. We talked about last week that forgiveness is a promise and a process. It is a promise that we're forgiven, and once again, there's that vertical element of me and my relationship with my Creator, just us. But there is also a process of forgiveness when I interact with you. When we interact with each other, eventually there's going to be a conflict. There's going to be a disagreement. There would be maybe even hurt feelings, broken relationships. Estranged is a word that sometimes we use to describe that. Forgiveness is in the horizontal plane too. That we live it. I'm able to forgive others because I have been forgiven. Well, the word that we're going to look at today is obviously life. And that also operates in that same paradigm, that God has given me life, eternal life through Christ, but then I live a life in this horizontal plane with people. In the Bible, in the New Testament especially, most of the times where you see it, and if I remember the numbers right, I think 550 times in the New Testament. Most of those times, it's one of two different words, Greek words. One of them is life, as in our physical life. Jesus laid down his life, or when Stephen was martyred, that stoning ended his life. Okay, so it's the physical life. It would also be captured in the birth, a new life. Okay, so that's one of the contexts. The other one is bigger than that. It is a zest for life, or the life that we live. You know, it's less biological and more social. It's described in Dr. Gupta's book this way. According to a 2017 Pew Research report, Americans are searching for a sense of fulfillment in life. Okay, so that one is not the biological one of birth and death. It's what we do and how we are in interacting with each other. When these people are asked, they often point to what's a fulfilled life? Family, career, meaningful friendships, and good health. Okay? So if you're going to define what's a good life, you know, one of the things, kind of the exercises that I went through, think of a movie that has the word life in it. I thought of the Christmas movie. It's a Wonderful Life. Okay? I also thought of The Life of Brian, which was a horrible British comedy. But that's the interactive part. Okay? He continues, in addition to family, career, friendships, good health, but many people can have most or all of these things and still struggle with anxiety, depression, loneliness, and emptiness. Many of life's highs are fleeting. So people alternate between high life and low life experiences, going up and down. Can anybody relate to that? Cycles of life. We have situations in our life where everything, it's a mountaintop experience. But then difficulties come, tragedy. Just the aging process, you know? You can't do what you used to be able to do. At times, that's frustrating. Okay? This cycle of the ups and downs of life. This is not just a modern American phenomenon. Jesus' disciples were also searching for life. There is something that humans long for that transcends the satisfactions of our basic needs. Food, shelter. Humans can only find true fulfillment or abundant life in Christ Jesus, who is life itself. So how do we put this together, and what's the point of this? So as I was kind of narrowing down, I mean, if you look at 550 kind of expressions of the word life in the New International Version of the Bible, obviously, it's like last week, it's a huge topic. So what we're going to do again is we're going to narrow this down. And in order to do that, I picked the top 10 scriptures, not from the entire Bible, that's too big. Not just from the New Testament, that was too big. I picked the top 10 from the Gospel of John, okay? John wrote, his style of writing was a little different than obviously Mark or Luke. Mark is the newspaper reporter, just the facts, ma'am. Shorter, more concise, directly to the point. Luke gave us lots of details in the Gospel of Luke and the book of Acts. Very historical, even medical scientific at times, very detailed, lots of words, lots of descriptors. John is even a little different. He writes almost at times like poetry, with prose, with lots of allegory, light and dark, good, representing good and evil, a lot of parables. And so we picked that because he wrote a lot about this life, both the the physical life of Jesus, obviously, but the more poetic and the more allegoric also. So we're going to take the top 10. Now, these are not in any particular order other than from the first part of the book to the last part. So the early part, you know, chapter 1 through 21. And so we're going to fly through these, but I want to challenge you. Think about which life he's talking about. Most of these are one or the other. Pretty easily discernible. And then I want us to think about them, what he's teaching us. Why is this verse in the Bible? Now, some of them are John. John is saying something. But the ones that have quotes around them, you'll see it. Some of them are Jesus words. So they're in red if you have a paper Bible. And so we'll discern. And I think there's one that actually, Peter's quote from the book of John. Anyway, let's fly through them. And then when we get to the last one, we're going to spend a little more time on that one. Okay? Here's the plan. In him was life, and that life was the light of all mankind. Okay? So this is in the beautiful, and maybe we really should, I probably should read the first, because this is the beginning of the Gospel of John, that once again, he's being very poetic. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was with God in the beginning, and through him all things were made. Without him, nothing has been made that has been made. In him was life, and that life was the light of all mankind. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness has not overcome it. And then he goes on in talking about next, John the Baptist. So John is starting off his gospel by saying Jesus is life. And that life, Jesus' life in us, is like light in darkness. Okay? Second one. Obviously you know this one, or I hope you do. It is probably the most, popular, if that's the right way of describing God's scripture, God's word. For God so loved the world that he gave. God initiates, and that initiation toward us is motivated because of his love. For God so loved the world, he gave. We see that throughout the Bible. God initiates relationship with humanity. Think about in Genesis 3 when Adam and Eve had sinned and they went and hid. This is the first picture of the gospel, of the God of the gospel. They were hiding. They disconnected. They estranged themselves. But God initiated. He went after them. He spoke to them. For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish, but have eternal life. That's not the physical body definition. That's the Zoe, is the Greek word. The Zoe form of it. Eternal life. Wonderful life, if you will. Okay? We know that one. This is in John chapter 24. It's one of my favorite verses in a gospel presentation to people. Very truly I tell you, whoever hears my word and believes him who sent me has eternal life and will not be judged, but has crossed over from death to life. Fits with Romans 6:23. The wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life. And you've seen, I think most of you have seen where I draw that out. We can draw that out as a gospel presentation. Death is on this side of the canyon, and the gift of life is on this side of the canyon, the Grand Canyon. And we're separated from God. I'm over here. God is over here. Death, life. Me, God, but how do I cross over? For the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life. There's five more words. Through Christ Jesus, our Lord. He's the bridge that we cross over to life. Okay? This one is probably familiar to you many times. Maybe you grew up a priest or a pastor or an elder may have read this during communion time. Jesus says, I am the bread of life. What does that mean? Why did he pick bread? Why didn't he say, I am the warmth of life? Or I am the spice of life. I'm the bread of life. The very basic thing, the most elemental. Bread is in all cultures. And Jesus says, I'm the bread of all cultures, of all people. I'm the nutrition. I'm the basic thing you need to live. I'm the bread of life. Whoever comes to me will never go hungry. Whoever believes in me will never be thirsty. And just like we have kind of two perspectives on life, one of the words life is our physical life. The other one, zoe, the Greek word, is this one, eternal life, abundant life. Okay? Just like that, he's also using hungry and thirsty in a spiritual realm. He says, if you're with me, who you come to me, you'll never be hungry or thirsty. Can you imagine? Are you living that? He offers that. Somehow he makes a claim. Jesus makes a claim. It's one of the I ams in the Gospel of John. I am the resurrection. I am the bread of life. I am the gate. I am the way. He said, I'm the basic thing you need to live. If you'll come to me, what does that mean? You'll never be hungry or thirsty again. Okay? This was interesting. It took me a while to find this because I was thinking it was, I didn't think it was in the Gospel of John. This is right after the bread of life talk. And Jesus continues in John chapter 6 and he says, this is my body given for you. My flesh, eat my flesh. This is my blood, drink my blood. And that's a little unsettling. That was a different teaching. And there were people, not the 12, but other disciples, that it got a little too weird for them. I mean, is he really talking about cannibalism? What is this dude? This dude's crazy. He's either demon-possessed or he's lost it. And so there's a little bit of a conversation between Jesus and the disciples and basically says, are you going to leave too? All these other people, the teaching got too hard. You know, if you don't like the heat, get out of the kitchen. Some of them got out. And so Jesus turns to the 12 and says, are you also going to leave? And Peter's reply is this, Lord, to whom shall we go? You have the words of eternal life. How about your faith? Is Jesus all warm and fuzzy as long as things are going well? But when the wheels fall off, do you disengage? Do you estrange yourself? Well, where else are you going? Peter says, to whom should we go? There's no one else. We're here. No matter what happens, we're staying with you. You have the words of life. Obviously, this is one that you probably would have put in a list taken from the Gospel of John. Jesus is telling the disciples, preparing them for his death. And he says, you know the way to the place that I'm going. Peter says, wait a minute. We don't know where you're going, so how can we know the way? And this is Jesus' famous reply. I am the way, the truth, and the life. I'm the life that you're looking for. Haven't there been times in your life that you kind of in some questioning way may not be the exact words or the exact phrase, but haven't there been times, and maybe even you're there now, where you've asked yourself the question, isn't there more to life than this? Or maybe subconsciously, you're asking God, not yourself. Maybe what you're really doing is asking God, is this all there is? The disciples did. Humans have done it for years. And Jesus is telling us, I'm the way, I'm the truth, I'm the life. John chapter 11, the famous story, the raising of Lazarus. Lazarus has died. Jesus tells the disciples, okay, now that he's died, now we can go. I'm sure they were confused with that whole deal. I don't know why we didn't go while he was still alive, Jesus. You waited till he died. You got another message, Lazarus is dead, and now you want to go? What's up? They go, they meet Martha, who comes out of the house, meets them in the driveway, and basically, in my mind, I picture her pointing her finger at him as she approaches, saying, if you had been here, my brother would not have died. Now, I don't know that she did it that way. Maybe she wasn't bold or crass enough to point her finger at Jesus. But in my mind, that's how she did it. Jesus has a conversation with her, which includes this promise. I am the resurrection and the life. Resurrection. Maybe that's his physical body. And the life. That's that thing that's less tangible. The one who believes in me will live, even though he dies. And whoever lives by believing in me will never die. And then he asks her a question. Do you believe this? Like righteousness, like the gospel, and like forgiveness, life is also a vertical relationship with God. An accepting or rejecting. A demanding or yielding view of life. But it's also a horizontal thing. Once we've received life, we have the gospel in righteousness. And, you know, we can share it with others because we've been forgiven. This is no different. It's the same thing. Jesus says, I am the resurrection and the life that you're looking for. Okay? This is a challenging one. It appears more than just the Gospel of John. The other Gospel writers record something very similar. Anyone who loves their life will lose it, while anyone who hates their life in this world will keep it for eternal life. Now, this passage is interesting because it has both of the words. Let me get the other one. Zoe is the eternal life. That's the last one in that passage. The other Greek word is psuche, P-S-U-C-H-E, is the transliterated Greek to English. Psuche. That's the first two. That's our physical life. Psuche and Zoe, Z-O-E. Anyone who loves their life, their physical life, their things, their accomplishments, this life, will lose it. If you love this life more than everything else, you'll lose it. It will slip through the fingers of your hand. While anyone who hates this life, and he's not talking about hating each other, but but it's a comparison. A comparison. If you love this life, or if you hate this life, you'll keep it. And then he switches, John switches to Zoe, and he describes an eternal life. So basically he's saying, you give up life to get life. My question is, have you done that? Do you do that? Is it a way that we live? We give up life to get life. We give up suke to get Zoe. What does it profit a man to gain the whole world? The suke life. But to lose his soul. To lose the Zoe life. And this one is Jesus a few hours before he went to the cross. In John chapter 17, we believe he's in the Garden of Gethsemane and he's praying. And he's talking to God, his Father. Now, this is eternal life. So he's asking some things, but he's acknowledging some things before, in obedience before God his Father. This is one of the things that he's acknowledging. This is eternal life, that they, the disciples, and us. So Jesus is praying for you and me. This is eternal life, that they know you, the only true God, and Jesus Christ, whom you have sent. Jesus is praying for us, praying for you and me. And he says, here's what eternal life is. That they know us. They know you as Father. They know me as the Son. They know the Holy Spirit as the empowerment for living when I ascend back to you. And here's the one we're going to close with. We're going back a few chapters. This is John chapter 10, but this is the one that overarches in my mind, at least in this message. Jesus spends about 39 verses in chapter 10. I think it's 1 to 39, might be to 41. And he's building a story around sheep and a shepherd. Okay? So I'm pulling one verse out. But we need go ahead and read it and understand it. This will be your springboard, the one verse. But put it in context. He's talking about a shepherd that takes care of the sheep. But he's speaking to the Pharisees. He's not speaking, if you'll read it, I think it's verse 1. He's speaking to the Pharisees, the religious hypocrites, those who he knew were planning to kill him. Those who acted very religious, down to every jot and tittle, everything. But they didn't know life. They were whitewashed tombs. There was no life in them. So he's speaking to them and he says, a shepherd lays down his life. A shepherd takes care of the sheep. The sheep know the shepherd's voice. But a thief, and he's talking about them. A thief comes only to steal, kill, and destroy. I have come. And so now he's right in their faces, and he's making a contrast. You have come to steal and kill and destroy. You're only interested in you. I have come to lay down my life for the sheep. I have come that they may have life and have it to the full, or have it abundantly. So there's the question for all of us. Jesus tells us right here, he makes a claim why he came to this earth. It wasn't to lead us in a good moral example that we love our neighbor, that we live life generously, that we turn the other cheek. All teachings of Jesus, all expressions of the truth. But he came that we might have life. To seek and save sinners, the Bible says. But he also puts something else on here. I have come that they might have life. And put it in the first person. Hear this as if Jesus is saying it to you. I came here so that you could have life and have it abundantly. Are you living an abundant and full life? Or are you just existing? Jesus came for both, that we would have life. Our heart beats. We breathe in and out. We go to and fro. We interact. He came that we would have life, but that we would have Zoe life. And not just Zoe life, abundant, overflowing. Overflowing. There are seasons where my life is like that. There are other seasons where I feel like it's a drought. Not quite a famine, but, you know, it's a short period. It doesn't feel abundant. But if I really look at that, it's times where I'm not connected. John 15 talks about being connected to the vine. Unless you're connected to the vine, you're not going to produce fruit. Take any plant you want. You cut the vine, you cut the root, you cut the stalk, you cut the limb, wherever that seed is. If you detach it from the vine, the root, the trunk, it's not going to produce. It's dying. So we have to stay connected, and at times I'm not. Well, how does that live out in my life? I'm going to close with a video that some of you have heard this song. It's by a man by the name of Toby McKeon, Toby Mac. The song was written a number of years ago, and it is entitled Speak Life. Okay, now, this is not some name it and claim it perverted gospel. I'm not saying all you have to do is believe it and speak it and it'll come true. That's not the gospel. Okay, but our words, the Proverbs and the book of James, our words have meaning. The Bible tells us that. They're powerful. And when I am not living the abundant life that God empowers me to live, when I get selfish, when I get frustrated, and it happened on Thursday with me. Long story short, but it was in a no-win situation. I had no choices with a cousin of mine. And she got frustrated, and I got frustrated. And I didn't speak words of life. I spoke words to defend myself. Have you ever done that? You're more concerned about defending yourself? About being right? That's not the abundant life. Man, I'm thankful because of the gospel and the righteousness that Jesus imputed in me, I'm still forgiven. That's the vertical part of it. But I got to figure out how do I live this. And I want to speak the words I say, but also the life I live. I want to speak life. Now, what's ironic about this is that about 6 years after he wrote this song, most of you know this story, his oldest son, Truett, accidentally overdosed. And I read an article where he describes this song is a totally different meaning when those things happen in life. We'll listen to this song, and then I'll close in prayer.
Some days life feels perfect. Other days it just ain't working. The good, the bad, the right, the wrong, and everything in between. Yo, it's crazy, amazing. We can turn our heart through the words we say. Mountains crumble with every syllable. Broken, live or die. So speak life, speak life to the dead and darkest night. Speak life, speak life when the sun won't shine and you don't know why. Look into the eyes of the broken hearted. Watch them come alive as soon as you speak hope. You speak love. You speak. Gets twisted. Other days my thoughts just fall apart. I do, I don't, I will, I won't. It's like I'm drowning in the deep. Well, it's crazy to imagine words from my lips as the arms of compassion. Mountains crumble with every syllable. Hope can live or die. So speak life. Rain when you speak life with the words you say. Raise your thoughts a little higher. Use your words to inspire. Joy will fall like rain when you speak life with the things you say. Lift your head a little higher. Spread the love like fire. Hope will fall like rain when you speak life with the words you say. So speak life.
Let's pray together. Father, we thank you that through Jesus, you give us life. You are life. What an amazing gift. While we're dead in our sin, while we're broken, you initiate into this world, into humanity, to give us life and to give it abundantly. Where else will we turn? There's no one else who has the words of life. So Father, help us more and more each day to look to you for life, to reach toward you for life. Help us to walk in your life. Help us to speak life. You are the way, the truth, and the life. Help us to know that more and more. We're grateful and we're thankful. In Jesus' name.